Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Memorial Day weekend. By way of announcements, I would like to thank Joan and Phil for the beautiful flowers up front and how it graces us and blesses us all at the same time. Thank you. And because it is Memorial Day, I would like to take a moment and recognize those people who have served in our country, for our country. So, can I have our veterans stand, please? Thank you. Thank you for your service, all of you. But there's something else I'd like to ask. Is there anyone here who was married to someone who served? Would you stand? You can see that. And I'm going to guess we have aunts and uncles who served, grandparents who served, children who served. And to that, I give thanks to God for that part that is within a human being to say, I give my life, I give my service, I give my faith in this country and in a country that is, you know, we're in a rough spot right now. We have been for a while. And to still know that there are those among us who serve. So, thank you. Now, we have an announcement that we are going to send around a clipboard. And anyone who is just wanting so badly to be an usher, please sign up. Actually, sign up if you don't want to be an usher. Just sign up.
I'm just going to leave the clipboard here and back so we don't have to pass it around. But please, 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 we've got several days that we only have one person be an usher and greeter. We need at least two, preferably four. So please think about it. I'm gonna leave it back here on the by the vestibule, and please look at it and sign up. Thank you.
Thank you. You know how when we go without something and then it happens the next time, we really appreciate it? Well, we have no extra music today, but next week, hold on to your hats. We're going to have all kinds of special music next week. So be prepared. Oh, well, we do have Joyful Noise special music. Yes. I'm talking about an introit and a closing. So excuse me. I didn't make that clear. We are going to have some very special music and some very special motion today. So with that, I'm going to turn the service over to Sharon, who doesn't have glasses on. Just take note of that.
And we'll see. We'll see if I can see it, because this eye does, this eye doesn't. Oh, it's good. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God.
Let us hold fast to our confession.
For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness.
But we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin.
Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness,
so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Amen. And we're going to read with response Psalm 104, 24 through 34 and 35b. Lord, you have done so many things. You made them all so wisely. The earth is full of your creations.
And then there's the sea, wide and deep, with its countless creatures. Living things, both small and large.
There go the ships on it, and Leviathan, which you made plays in it.
All your creations wait for you to give them their food on time.
When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled completely full.
When you hide your face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to dust.
When you let loose your breath, they are created. And you make the surface of the ground brand new again.
Let the Lord's glory last forever. Let the Lord rejoice in all he has made.
He has only to look at the earth and it shakes. God just touches the mountains and they erupt in smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I'm still alive.
Let my praise be pleasing to him. I'm rejoicing in the Lord. But let my whole being bless the Lord. Praise the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Praise the Lord.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And we'll sing together 404, Every Time I Feel the Spirit.
Please rise.
Our scripture today is Acts 2, 1 through 21. When Pentecost Day arrived, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound from heaven, like the howling of a fierce wind, filled the entire house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be an individual flames of fire alighting on each one of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. There were pious Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. When they heard this sound, a crowd gathered. They were mystified because everyone heard them speaking in their native languages. They were surprised and amazed, saying, "Look, aren't all the people who are speaking Galileans, every one of them?" How then can each of us hear them speaking in our native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, as well as residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the regions of Libya bordering Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the mighty works of God in our own languages. They were all surprised and bewildered. Some asked each other, "What does this mean?" Others jeered at them, saying, "They're full of new wine." Peter stood with the other 11 apostles, and he raised his voice and declared, "Judeans and everyone living in Jerusalem, know this. Listen carefully to my words. These people aren't drunk as you suspect. After all, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. Rather, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young will see visions. Your old elders will dream dreams. And even upon my servants, men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will cause wonders to occur in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and a cloud of smoke. The sun will be changed into darkness and the moon will be changed into blood before the great spectacular day of the Lord comes. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank
you. And now will our performance and performers come forward?
To the left, I'll fly, fly, fly to the right, I'll fly, fly.
You guys did great. Oh, there's another one. Oh my God. Oh, sorry. Sorry, guys. Very good. Now,
okay. I was a tree growing tall and green. All I wanted you to shade me and me.
Thank you. That's beautiful. And it's, thank you. You did a great job. Thank you. Yeah, well, I'll hang it on my wall at home. That's wonderful. Thank you. You grew me, too. You know, you've taught me a lot, too. Oh. Thank you. Thank you. You just want a double treat. I know how it is. All right. Go for it. All right. Oh, and they are taken too. I think there's just, oh, they're just, well, I don't know. They're, all right. There's probably enough. Yeah, no, go ahead. Go ahead. Take another if you only got. All right. Have fun. Thank you. No one said that retirement was going to be so painful. Painful. So let's stand and sing Spirit of the Living God, 539, please.
Thank you.
Got to check my, oh, I now hear myself. And I do have low battery, so I'm going to just take a moment. It's better. Let me have a moment in which I can pray. Father, I don't want this to be just another Bible story that, you know, we've heard so many times that it doesn't really resonate with us anymore. Help me to breathe into this for me, to those listening, what this memo, what this meaning, what this moment is meant to be now and from on, from here on. Help me know this as it was spoken, not as I understand it. Let us find the experience of this that we may share in such a way that all we meet will call on the name of the Lord and be saved, to know this. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Nearly every year, I read this. It's the common thing to read on Pentecost Sunday. And every year, I think I have missed a really important statement. Verse 5, there were pious Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. All this time, I thought it was just visitors. But these were people who had integrated themselves within the group and were practicing Judaism, although they were diverse from every country, not born Jews, but those affirming what it is to be a Jew. The Torah, the one God, the prophets, the festivals, the holidays, the Exodus story, and the exile story. A recent conversation that I had with a chiropractor I was visiting from Southwest Iowa, he said that he had a question that it was burning on his heart because he talked to his pastor and he talked to others and he never really got a really good answer. So he was going to test a Methodist pastor, I guess. You know, those Methodists, who knows what they know. And he said, I've been reading in the Old Testament, and over and over and over, God's chosen people annihilated other people. There were great wars, and they were always against what would be considered a Gentile, someone who was not practicing Judaism, did not believe in the things that I've just listed. And he said, the bottom line is, I'm a Gentile. And he said, so is there any real hope for me? I mean, where am I in this picture? And he said, oh, I know all the Jesus stuff, but I also know that he came to save the Jew first and then the Gentile. And he said, I'm really conflicted with this. And so I told him, in the best way that I know how to understand it, is that if you were going to run a campaign convincing people that they should believe in God, what kind of a campaign would you run? You'd run a campaign where your God was the winner of every battle. You'd run a campaign where your God did great and mighty things. You'd run a campaign where you wanted to convince people that this is who they should believe in and how they should believe. And how they should live, and the why, and the where, and the how, and all those other ones. Which one? All that. And I said, and then, you know, remember that even when they annihilated everyone, there was always a remnant left of everyone that they went to war against. There was always a remnant left. And it is within that remnant that they began to believe too. And I said, guess what you are? You're the remnant. And so he said, that's the best answer I've ever had. He didn't take anything off my bill, though. I just want you to know. I got charged the whole thing. This scripture is talking a little bit about this right here. The God of Israel and Judah, what we would call the Jewish people, were busy making God-fearing people out of all nations. Sounds like something we have as our vision, making disciples of the world for the transformation of the world in believing in Jesus. I just annihilated that thing, didn't I? I'm sorry. The disciples and others in the upper room were filled with this Holy Spirit. Holy, all-knowing, all-present, Holy Spirit. Not a drunken spirit or a spirit of righteousness or piety or enmity against those who denied and crucified Christ, but this is Holy Spirit. God in spirit form among them. No longer in flesh, but in an uncontainable, unformable, uncontrolled presence of God within them. They had not been in the upper room taking Rosetta Stone, listening to the Rosetta Stone tapes to learn a foreign language. It fell upon them, and they did not know of even what they spoke. So as God is speaking through the willing vessel of the disciples and others in the upper room to every one of the fulfilled prophecy in Joel. And Peter simply tells them to know this. To know something is to move it from suspicion or investigation to a state of understanding and affirmation. According to the Oxford Dictionary, know is a verb that means be aware of through observation, inquiry, or information. Have knowledge or information concerning. Have developed a relationship, I love that, with through meeting or spending time with. That's to know. And these Jews would know the prophecy of Joel. It is what they have been waiting on. They've been waiting for this fulfillment in the Messiah, and the subsequent infilling of the Spirit of God was what they were waiting for. All the Jews were waiting for that. Remember, I've reminded us last week, people had eternal life before Jesus died. The righteous obtained eternal life. The righteous is a way of being just, kind, humble, knowing God, which requires a relationship with God. Remember that definition, which comes through prayer, fasting, silence, and for those prior to Jesus, sacrifice, as in sacrificing lambs, doves, etc. Those that are in earshot, know what it is to be a good Jew. Maybe even if they were not fully practicing it, they knew. And they also were waiting for something more from God, such as the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. As it says in verse 18, even upon my servants, men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. Which people? All people. It is there for taking. It is still there for taking. God is just waiting for us to say, let's do this. Let's do this, Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God waits, and it's never pushy. It's always been referred to as like a gentleman. It's never pushy. Overwhelming, never overwhelming, but is waiting for us, waiting for you. And what does it have for you? Why do you think you need to have this? Listen to the words in 1 Corinthians 12, 7 through 11. The Holy Spirit in each person, in one way or another, for the good of all. We do not have a franchise, cannot franchise the Spirit of God. It is more about what, through you can do for others. So this desire to have it for you, you know, like, I have it in my basket. I'm all happy. That's not going to happen. The only way that it will fill you is when you are willing to fill others. One person is given the gift of teaching words of wisdom for the good of all. Another person is given the gift of teaching what he has learned and knows for the good of all. These gifts are by the same Holy Spirit. One person receives the gift of faith for the good of all. This faith is not the I believe kind of faith that we, you know, that we often talk about faith and put it right along with I believe, faith, I believe. This is the kind of faith that says to mountains, be cast into the sea. Another person receives the gifts of healing for the good of all. These gifts are given by the same Holy Spirit. One person is given by the gift of doing good, powerful works for the good of all. Another person is given the gift of speaking God's word for the good of all. Another person is given the gift of telling the difference between the Holy Spirit and false spirits. Another person is given the gift of speaking in special sounds. Another person is given the gift of telling what these special sounds mean. But it is the same Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, who does all these things. He gives to each person as God wants to give. This is not your grocery list of gifts, but God who chooses. Who does God give these to? Is there some criteria to receiving these? And the answer to that is no, because remember, the least likely. I railed against religion when I was a young person. And then December 13th, 1981, God got a hold of this song and gave me a new name and said, just wait, we're going on a crazy ride, you and I. And God has done just that. And I sought the Holy Spirit like a dog after a bone. I was all in. I wanted to know every part of this. Don't give me just a little. Give me everything you got. So let me pose a question that only you can answer. Do you know this? Do you know this? What is your spiritual journey? What gifts has God manifested in you through the Holy Spirit? And I've been reading, and you know that always gets us in trouble. But let's look at a different spiritual journey under the umbrella of knowing God. In the time of Jesus' life and death, and for centuries prior to the printing press and the common human being able to read, believing looked a bit differently. Knowing was a bit different. Only an educated few had access to the Word of God, be it the Torah, the prophets, the wisdom teachings, etc. It was just a few people. So to say that you believe in the scriptures, it was to say that you believe in God, period. They didn't have a hard copy of the Torah in their back pocket, or, you know, that handy, you know, pocket-sized Bible that sometimes we carry and the Gideons are so good to give us. Believing was in what you heard and how you understood and how you should live. It would be what you know of God, of God's presence in your life. That Holy Spirit? The term Holy Word of God would not be spoken of because it was a non-existing thing to the regular person, the Jew or Gentile. Believing was about the relationship you had with God, the knowing, which indeed was the moving of God's Spirit among the people who called upon God's name, lived kind, humble, righteous lives. Being equated to how you lived was believing, not on how, what you thought you knew. It was much like believing. So let's run with that for a moment. What would our world look like today if we didn't argue about the content of the Bible, but simply held the context of the Bible as the Word of God that we could hold on to? We couldn't argue chapter and verse, but we remember the high points. Much like we give the children in Sunday school. You know, stories of faithfulness in Isaac and Noah and Abraham. Stories of leadership in Moses and Isaiah and Jeremiah, the kings, Joshua. Stories of submission as in Naomi and Esther and Rahab and Mary. And stories of deliverance such as Exodus and the exile. And the list goes on, wouldn't it? We would emulate what we believed from these characters of kindness and relationship with God and others, righteous living and deliverances. So in those early years, we would be living in a new movement of emulating Jesus, Paul, Timothy, John, Barnabas, James, all the Marys. We would believe that this great prophecy of the Messiah had arrived and new words of grace and mercy would be part of what we did for others because we believed in these stories, even if we couldn't repeat them verbatim or look them up in our Bible, but because they stirred something in our heart that made us want to live a new and better way. Believing is knowing through our actions. Knowing through our actions is often seen in our children. They emulate us to those that they meet. Children are great litmus papers of the household that they are being raised in. No wonder Jesus said, "Suffer me the little children." In other words, let me have the little children because if they keep their eyes on me, they will know how to be living. Maybe the world would be a better place if we simply believed instead of knowing. So back to the scripture. That was kind of the sermon inside the sermon. But Paul says, know this. That wasn't Paul, Peter. And Peter says, know this. And they do know it. They do have head knowledge of it. Yet imagine the reality in that moment that all the ears of all nations hear that they themselves, which means their nation, will be saved by calling on the Lord's name. And what does that really look like? I think that calling on the Lord's name looks a lot like prayer. When do we call on the Lord's name? When we call on it when we're in need, right? Or when we are depressed. Or when we are happy. When we are looking for direction, healing, wisdom, hope, deliverance, and respite, and resolution. We call out to God and we converse. We call out in the name of the Lord and the Spirit of God answers. This three-in-one Trinity is God who loves us and desires to know God enough to know God's will in our lives for others as well as ourselves, but for others. God wants us to have a spirit-filled life. Filled. Not just, you know, a little sprinkle here and there. He wants us filled. God wants us to live in the Spirit of God as God is Spirit. Last week we talked about our transformational journey from the beginning of believing to living a transformed life. How do you think you get from point A to point B? It's by the infilling of the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, you're just pushing your own preconceived idea of spirituality like a boulder uphill. And eventually, you tire. You give up. And hopefully, you have enough energy to roll out of the way before the big boulder rolls back down the hill. That's called gravity. They describe the belief system of the Pharisees, where they push until even Jesus couldn't live by it. The hymns we sing today talk about a newness in the Spirit, when we feel the Spirit in what we are doing, or when it falls afresh on us, and the knowledge that wherever we are, when the Spirit falls afresh on us, it is holy ground. When the Spirit made its presence known on that day of Pentecost, Some acted in fear. But God did not give us a spirit of fear, but that through the Holy Spirit, we could be fearless and overcoming. We can be transformed. Know this. Continue in your journey with the Holy Spirit. Yesterday I was asked at a meeting, what is your word of wisdom to us? And I said, stay on the journey. Stay on the journey. That's my word of wisdom to you today. Stay on the journey. It's one transformational moment from the next, but you just stay in there. That's all I got to say. Amen. If our ushers would prepare themselves for offering. All right. Father, for the good of others, for the good of others that we give, for the good of others that we receive as well. So, Lord, this is the response to your action, and we ask that you bless it and the givers alike. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated as we prepare our thoughts on our sharing. I would like to say for Phil has a good friend, Keith, who is having open heart surgery tomorrow. And it sounds like a really intense kind of open heart surgery that he's having. So I ask that you remember Keith in your prayers. Generous God. Anyone else? I've got Peg. They're coming.
Sorry. My sister passed away Thursday after a long, long battle with Alzheimer's. I just asked for prayers for my family to get through it without any controversy. And I think we're all struggling. Out of Dean's and my family, there's 13 siblings. And this is the first one we've lost. So it's kind of new to everybody. And I just ask that my family is peaceful with each other.
Amen. Generous God. Please remember Cheryl. Not Cheryl. Cheryl's in a great place. Remember the family. We're quiet today. It's all right. Well, Tom's going to have a word. Okay.
I was going to be disappointed that you didn't have anything to say. I was going to be disappointed that you didn't have anything to say.
Well, yeah, there's always something to say. And there's always something to be joyful about.
Amen.
Yeah. Nothing in particular, but your last words resonated with me. Stay on the journey. And I just got to thinking, you know, we've been on a journey here since Pastor Linda joined our ranks. And I just think about the journey, where we were and where we are now and where we're going. And, you know, at times you just wonder, well, what's the next step? What do I do now in my life, in our church, in this crazy mixed up world? Well, that just kind of hit home. Just stay on the journey. Keep worshiping God. And I think we'll be okay.
Amen. Generous God, on our next steps, I'm excited.
Hi, this is Julie Sanford. So I just wanted to say that my mom's 86th birthday will be on Tuesday, and one of her things that she wanted to always do was go to the Missouri Star Quilt Company. So two of my sisters and I took her Friday, and you know, we spent Friday and Saturday down in Missouri, and she enjoyed herself really well. So something we were able to do, because you never know if she'll be here next year.
That's right.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Gotta love 85th birthdays. Generous God.
Well, I just want to thank all of you guys for being here. My youngest daughter, suffered a double concussion. Her name's Heather, so I'm just asking prayers for Heather. She's having a really tough time, and she's with the neurology unit and all that stuff, but it's just difficult. She's all alone, and so just asking for prayers for Heather.
Prayers for Heather. Generous God. So with that, let us just take a moment and center ourselves. For the good of others, God. For the good of others. That is so often why we ask for these prayer requests. And seldom is it about us, but for the good of others. So it is for the good of others that we lift up Keith, and not just Keith, but the surgeons surrounding Keith and the staff surrounding Keith, that his surgery will go well. That we lift up Heather. As she heals, as she is knitted back together every whit whole. And for the worry that accompanies both of these by the people that love them, we ask for healing for them as well, assurance for them as well. And we lift up celebration, the celebration of 85th birthdays and the things in life that matter, like quilts that are knitted together, sewn together, put together, piece by piece, just like we are. What an extension of who we are. And 85 years of loving those things that give us comfort and joy. And it is, Lord, that we also know that there are among us the people who have lost. As we lift up Peg's family and the loss of their sister, and we ask for healing and knitting together, sewing together, that fabric of what it is to be family. And to remember that all hurt, and all hurt in different ways. And Father, we ask a special touch to them. And Lord, to us, as we celebrate the next steps, the next motion in our journey, in our transformation journey, as individuals, but also as a group. And Lord, be with us in this journey. Let us know when to move forward and when to hold back, when to throw the net on one side or to throw the net on the other side. Lord, let us know. Lead us, guide us, direct us. For others, but also, Lord, for ourselves, that we may come to know you better, more, distinctly. And that in the knowing, we know that you are with us each and every day of our lives, because we remember the one who called us here when we say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Amen. Holy Ground, 2272. Please rise. God is good all the time.
All the time. God is good.
Go in peace.
bless you. Lord bless you.